In Baltimore, where the Francis Scott Key Bridge collapsed early today after being hit by a cargo ship that lost power.
This is one of the cathedrals of American infrastructure. It has been part of the skyline of this region for longer than many of us have been alive.
He says rebuilding will take time, pledging as much federal help as it takes. Right now, a search and rescue mission continues for six people unaccounted for. Independent presidential hopeful Robert F. Kennedy Jr. just announcing his running mate.
My fellow lawyer, a brilliant scientist, technologist, a fierce warrior mom, Nicole Shanahan.
She's also a philanthropist, the ex-wife of a Google co-founder. Kennedy says Shanahan shares his concern about big tech's role in what he calls the government's censorship, surveillance, and information warfare against the American people. He's still trying to get on the ballot around the country. About half of the states require a running mate for that process. An Idaho mayor says racist incidents targeting visiting college basketball players are believed to have been a serious threat to the students' safety. The driver of a truck with a Confederate flag yelling racist slurs at two teams walking to dinner in Coeur d'Alene, slurs that later continue, the mayor says, engines revving with others joining in. Mayor Jim Hammond.
I want to make it very clear and very loud that we can be on the strongest terms. Those horrendous acts of hatred, and if the perpetrators can be found, we call upon them to be prosecuted.
The University of Utah women's basketball coach had said her team was subjected to racist incidents and moved hotels after arriving in Coeur d'Alene for the NCAA tournament. A mix of stocks finish lower, turning lower just before the bell. The Dow down 31 points. America's listening to Fox News.
Life insurance. Why are you putting it off? Can't afford it? Too much hassle? Think you don't need it? There's lots of excuses for putting off life insurance. But if you weren't there, who would pay the mortgage and other bills? With Ethos, you could be covered in 10 minutes and boom, family protected. Ethos, fast and easy online term life insurance. Up to $2 million in coverage with no medical exam. Some policies as low as a dollar a day. Answer a few health questions and get your free quote at getethos.com. That's getethos.com. Do you find yourself stuck in a timeshare? Get the real facts about the timeshare industry and your options for cancellation. Chuck McDell, founder of Wesley Financial Group, has put together a free information guide that reveals the secrets the timeshare industry doesn't want you to know, including the five ways to get rid of your timeshare. Call now and get this timeshare information guide absolutely free. Call 800-919-3200. That's 800-919-3200. 800-919-3200.
The former president gets hit with a new gag order ahead of his first criminal trial.
Manhattan Judge Juan Merchan's issued a gag order against former President Trump. He's not allowed to make public statements about witnesses, court staff, jurors, and others in his case with an upcoming trial date set for April 15th. Merchan's overseeing the case in which the former president's charged with filing false business records when he reimbursed his then personal attorney for hush money payments to an adult film star who alleged an affair. The former president's been posting about Merchan on his social media app, calling him a certified Trump hater and calling out his daughter for working at a progressive agency. Merchan wrote, "It is without question that the imminency of the risk of harm is now paramount." Jessica Rosenthal, Fox News.
The former president posting about the case earlier today, a day after the judge set the trial date. The U.S. defense chief meets with his Israeli counterpart amid tensions over plans for a ground invasion in the city of Rafah, where more than a million people evacuated from elsewhere in Gaza are sheltering.
Israel's minister of defense meeting with defense secretary Lloyd Austin at the Pentagon, where Austin makes clear the U.S. supports Israel's right to defend itself.
Now, we continue to share the goal of seeing Hamas defeated. So we'll discuss alternative approaches to target Hamas elements.
Austin, though, says casualties in Gaza are far too high.
Fox's Ryan Schmelz in Washington, a senior U.S. defense official not offering any specifics on what alternatives the U.S. has suggested to a ground invasion. Today's previously scheduled meeting comes a day after the U.S. allowed a Gaza ceasefire resolution to pass the U.N. Security Council. In Haiti, gangs are intensifying a rampage that started yesterday in the downtown area of Port-au-Prince, the capital, nearly a month since gunmen began targeting key infrastructure across the city. President Biden earlier today approving up to $10 million in emergency assistance for Haitian security forces. Elisa Brady, Fox News.
Hello again, everyone. Let's check weather for East Central Illinois. Champaign and Van Nuys, Saturday is still in the midst of this storm system, continuing to generate a wide and expansive shield of moisture. A little more scattered, random nature, though, to rainfall here across East Central Illinois. The Twin Cities, snows up through the northern plains. Heavier rains into the lower Great Lakes region will likely do it all over again early next week. Temperatures will slowly fall back into the 40s late this afternoon and evening time. Gusty southwesterly winds to 40 miles per hour. Some shower activity, maybe a thunderstorm this morning, even a stray shower this afternoon. Blustery, colder tonight, down to 31. Partly sunny for the day tomorrow, colder and 47. We'll bottom out a little below freezing tomorrow night. Sunshine gets us back to 57 for the day on Thursday. Friday, milder, up to 64. Then over the weekend, some spotty shower activity on Saturday, the high near 65. Maybe a little rain late in the day, Easter Sunday at 58. Back into showers and thunderstorms here on Monday in the 60s. We'll cool back in the 50s with some dry time Tuesday of next week. For Stevie J, broadcasting meteorologist Greg Solge.
Good morning. It is The Drive, ESPN Radio 93.5. The Drive with Tay and Piper. Kyle Tosk, again, sitting in for Derek Piper. Should we just change the name of this show until Illinois is eliminated? And we hope that, like, for instance, we hope Piper's not here until April. We literally hope that Derek Piper, if we don't physically see Derek Piper until April, it would be the best thing in the world. For Illinois fans, right? Because that means they made it to the Final Four, hopefully made it to the championship game. And so I think we should file, like, would it be an injunction or something? Or we should just change the name.
What'll happen is I'll have my name on there for one day, and they'll lose Thursday night.
Yeah, you're right.
I have my one day of fame.
Everybody will then dislike Kyle Tosk. And for the rest of his life, he'll never have a radio show named after him because he'll be gun-shy to do it. He's like, don't name it after me. Whatever you do, don't put my name in it. So, all right, we'll keep it The Drive with Tay and Piper. But Kyle, obviously, a big part. And I did, you know, Derek mentioned that yesterday, that he's had the ability now to follow this team and do what he does. And, of course, I've said it 1,000 times, you coming aboard has allowed me, kind of like with Trevor Valise when he was here, not kind of like, it was just like, you guys have allowed me to see a lot of my son's baseball and basketball. So it is much appreciated, more than you'll ever know. I've always told you, you'll understand it one day when you have children. And then you'll kind of understand, you'll be like, oh, that's why Lon did. Wonder where Lon is now. That's what you'll be like, where's he at? What would he be like, 80 now? I wonder if he's still kicking down in Florida.
Yeah, I'll know exactly where you are. Don't get me wrong. Come on.
You'll be able to come visit. You'll bring your grandkids or your kids down, and I'll meet the little Tosks one day. That'd be kind of fun. I'll be like, hey, your dad had a radio show named after him for a day, and then everybody hated him because we lost. So no Pipes. He will join us again tomorrow around 4:30. We're planning on having Luke Goody on tomorrow as well. Both Luke Goody and Derek Piper, not together, are traveling to Boston today. So a lot of effort to, of course, get out to Boston. So that is stopping some of these chats today. We had thought about having Luke on today, but with him in the air. So we'll have Luke Goody on at some point tomorrow, Derek Piper at some point tomorrow, and maybe Sean Harrington at some point tomorrow. So we're going to be pretty busy. Plus, you and I are just going to be sitting back eating ribs and barbecue all day because Mr. Onstott is bringing the trailer, and he is going to be making up a lot of barbecue specials for Kyle and I and some others here in the radio station. I know he's going to – Diane, will he be on in the morning with you guys tomorrow with the meat or no? That'll just be on our show? Yeah. Okay.
He's pulling up
early. 70-foot rig. Okay. All right. So the entire town of Philo is going to walk down and want to purchase ribs, and he's going to be like, no, this is for Lon and Kyle, and that's it. So, yeah, so we've got a really jam-packed show tomorrow getting you ready for Illinois and Iowa State on Thursday. That game, of course, late at night, like between 9 and 9:30 or so, when tip-off will occur then. Again, a programming note, we will not be on Thursday due to the St. Louis Cardinals, who basically will play with eight guys. They don't have enough outfielders anymore, so it's going to be like a high school team that didn't have enough guys come out, or one guy got injured, or one guy didn't make the grades, and now they have an outfield of two guys. That's what it's going to be like for the Cardinals. They're going to have like Jordan Walker and Victor Scott start in the outfield. That's it. They're just going to have two guys start against the Dodgers and a full infield, and we'll see what happens on Thursday.
Is this the least excited you've been for opening day in like 25 years?
There's no doubt.
Pairing it with the fact that Illinois plays a Sweet 16 game the same night?
I'm glad that you said that, because I don't want people to think I'm some fair weather. I always get excited about Cardinals baseball. In fact, last season was the first time in my life I hadn't been down to a game. And I'm already planning an early trip in April for Andrew's birthday. We're going to go down and catch a game on a weekend. And then there's another weekend of games later in April that I think I'm going to try to get down to Busch Stadium. I was mad at myself, even as bad as the Cardinals were last year, I was mad at myself for not attending at least a game. I've always attended at least a game, and normally a handful of games. So I was mad at myself. I'm going to make it up to the Cardinals a little bit and go down and check out some maybe afternoon Saturday games this year when it's possible. But yeah, I was between Illinois advancing and then the fact that you have three of your four outfielders hurt right now. Lars Nootbaar's hurt, Tommy Edmonds hurt, and then Dylan Carlson ran into Jordan Walker. It's a wonder Walker's healthy. I mean, you had a chance with the collision yesterday to lose all four of your outfielders before the opening pitch of the season. I'm sorry, I laugh. It's terrible that these guys are getting injured, but of course, Tommy Edman was injured before spring training even started, so you can't blame spring training on that. But then Lars Nootbaar like dove for a ball into the wall and got hurt. He broke ribs. And then yesterday, Dylan Carlson had to brace himself after running into Jordan Walker, essentially, or Walker ran into him. He had to brace himself and injured his left wrist. And, of course, he's a lefty. It's like the AC joint is injured. Is that your shoulder or wrist? I think that'd be a shoulder.
Shoulder, yeah.
So he injured his shoulder. So now Dylan Carlson is injured. We don't know how long, unless that came out recently, that he's going on the injured reserve. But essentially, three of your projected four outfielders are out for the Cardinals. So Victor Scott, who actually came to the Cardinals caravan here in Champaign that SJ Broadcasting hosted, Victor Scott will now be in the lineup. And, of course, there's the Michael Ciani, who is a center fielder from from the Cincinnati Reds, who's really, honestly, a really good defensive center fielder, will also be playing. So it looks like you'll have Walker, Ciani, and Scott as your opening day outfield going up against those LA Dodgers out at Chavez Ravine. So that's what it is. But yeah, the other thing that's occurring that night, which is pretty cool, is Illinois playing in a Sweet 16 game against Iowa State. And I know you and I want to get to some thoughts on Iowa State and what we think of that team. Now, one thing did occur today, and that was the University of Illinois announced the Fighting Illini Athletics will host a doubleheader basketball watch party at State Farm Center on Thursday as the women's and men's basketball teams play postseason games. The gates will open at 6. The admission is free. And, Kyle, if you're one of the first 350 fans, you get a free hot dog. So just keep that in mind. That's courtesy of Illinois Student Affairs. They'll also have Coca-Cola on hand. And then later they've got alcohol as well. The concessions will open with some Twisted Tea, Icon beer, some Bud Light. So fans, if you're wanting to go, you should enter the West Main Gate at State Farm Center. Parking will be free in the Northwest and Southwest lots. I'll let you do the math or the mapping of that in your head. But the Northwest and Southwest lots, they're where you can park. And the activities, you can get in at 6. And, of course, the women's game starts at 6:30. The men should start around 9:10 is what we're projecting between then and 9:30. So any Any thoughts of you going to the State Farm Center to take part in that, or is that
I'm
something?
Still deciding what I want to do to watch this game.
Is that
I might
something
go home
would...
and watch it with my big...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I got a lot of Illini family back at home,
see,
so that's under
should.
Consideration as well.
You
but
should.
If I'm around here, I might head over okay. to State Farm.
I believe I have Jason and Corey teed up for Friday in case you're off. So just an FYI, you do not have to hang around here. I would like it if you went and watched it with your dad. You know your dad would love it if you went and watched it with him, especially if they were able to beat Iowa State and get to that Elite Eight game where they would probably face UConn. Come on, San Diego State. But that right. is something that that you can look forward to at State Farm Center if you're interested in doing that. So so go ahead and take advantage of that, of course, on Thursday, and that's at the State Farm Center. But, yeah, it would be interesting to see if they have a good crowd for that. I'm one of those that – for a 9:30 game, I am going to be at home for that one, ready probably to hit the hay after that thing ends on Thursday night. But we will look forward and look ahead to Iowa State and see what we can find out about that team, who we know is number one in the KenPom defensive efficiency category. So we know that they can play a lot of defense. We know that that's what they hang their hat on. They don't score a ton of points, obviously, whereas Illinois does. And Iowa State likes to trap. That is another thing that they enjoy doing. So Brad Underwood the last couple of days has been busy. I've seen him on every like small person podcast up to the Big Ten Network. I got on YouTube today and it was like 58 interviews with Brad Underwood with people I've never even heard of. And I'm like, okay, that's interesting. Who's this guy? This is like, hey, I'm Tom Smith from Brooklyn, New York, and I just wanted to see if I could get Coach on for 10 minutes on my daily podcast. Sure, let's do it. So we're going to play you the snippet from the Big Ten Network later with Brad Underwood as he joined the Big Ten Network gang and had some discussion on his squad, et cetera. All right, Iowa State, Kyle. I know the basics. They play really good defense. They love to trap, and they want you to work. They don't want you getting in the middle of their defense. Does that make sense?
Yeah, they play a no-middle defense.
Okay. They like to force you to the baseline. They like to force you out on the wing to where you're taking long-distance threes or you're getting yourself trapped in the corner. And, of course, we always say the baseline, the out-of-bounds line, if you will, is like a sixth defender. You're taught that as you come up through basketball and grade school and such, that you can use that line as another defender to try to trap someone. So that is essentially what they will do. Now, the scary part there, and this is where I'm going to leave it with you, we've talked all year about, and especially coming into the year, what is this team going to look like without a true point guard? Well, it has kind of morphed into it's fine. Because Marcus Damask has taken over that role. He's played the booty ball. He's done a lot of things. Now, he did have a propensity to have turnovers this year. There were games, especially later in the season, where he would turn the ball over four or five different times, and it got to be frustrating where he was dribbling too much, right? You've heard your coach say that as well. Stop dribbling, pass the ball, or keep the ball moving. And it seemed like the ball would stick sometimes with Damask. So while we don't worry necessarily about the point guard spot anymore, Kyle, do you worry about that spot going up against an Iowa State team that is so hell-bent on essentially making life, you know what, for a point guard?
I am a little more concerned when you talk about a team who turns you over so much. I mean, this is an Iowa State team second in the country in turnover rate force defensively. Illinois really hasn't gone up against that type of defense, and you honestly the most comparable scheme defense wise that they played was that game against Penn State, in which they did turn it over quite a bit and it led to their downfall, and obviously a game that's probably the least memorable from this season for Illini fans. So I think
you could say that about a lot of Penn State games in the past few years, you know.
Definitely 2 years ago. I don't even did we play Penn State 2 years
like
ago?
There was the year we scored like what 30 points or something.
No, the 38-33 game in 2010.
There's been a lot of unmemorable or non-memorable games against Penn State, that is for sure. So I'm glad I don't appreciate you even bringing them up, to be honest with you.
I do get a little bit concerned about it when you talk about not really having that true point guard. Illinois is not a team that's really turned it over a ton this year. even without it, but Iowa State's really going to force all five guys on the floor to handle the ball and to make good decisions, especially when you talk about Marcus Dumask, who Illinois is going to try to get into his booty ball actions, and Iowa State's going to aggressively trap him, try to force him baseline, try to turn him over. And I am encouraged about what I've seen from Dumask here lately as a passer and as a decision maker, because teams have, I mean, for the last 2 months, teams have thrown multiple guys at him and teams have tried to get him out of his rhythm, and he's really come a long way in terms of facilitating and impacting the game without maybe getting his shots. But I think it's definitely a concern, and one that Illinois is going to need to take care of the ball here and not let Iowa State force 18 turnovers on them, because honestly, that's going to be Iowa State's easiest offense in this game, and that's how they can really gain a lead on you, is if they're getting runouts and they're getting transition buckets, because otherwise I think they're going to have a tougher time keeping up with you offensively. But if you hand them free possessions and live ball turnovers, I think that's their biggest path to keeping up on the offensive end with you.
You've always heard the idea that to beat a zone, whether it be a press or just a half court, is to get the ball in the middle. And then it opens up so many options. The zone has to collapse. That opens up passing lanes. That opens up, you know, obviously driving lanes. And you sense that with this team. And, of course, as you mentioned, it's a no-middle defense. They don't want the ball in the middle. Who on this Illinois team can you see exploiting that a little bit? I know against Syracuse last year, Coleman Hawkins was great at getting the ball in the middle of the lane. Almost, you know, you look at their defense, it's not necessarily a zone, but it kind of has that principle sometimes where all of a sudden you got the five guys around almost like in a matchup zone, and they're just salivating to trap you. They don't care who it is, but they just cannot wait for somebody to get the ball in a bad spot, and then they're going to trap you and put a lot of pressure on you, and they're really good about reading the next pass. So they're able to recover to the next pass so that that guy doesn't have a wide open three, and then the next pass, they recover to that to where that guy doesn't have a wide open three. So they do a good job of the trap and recover, and that's something that Illinois is going to have to take advantage of somehow. Now, you can say that, you know, surely there's a way to beat that. Well, a lot of teams haven't. And it'll be interesting with the good news, I guess, although playing UConn, if you play UConn on a 2-day, that's not going to be exactly fun either to try to prepare for that squad in 1 day. But I guess the good news a little bit is that Illinois will have had some time here to prepare for this defense and kind of get their offense going. Now, I think of guys on the outside that can shoot quick. I think a Terrence Shannon obviously can get the ball up quick. Luke Goody is a guy that can do that. Gary A takes a little bit of time when he shoots. Coleman can snap it off quick.
I think Coleman is going to be really vital in this matchup, especially when you look at Iowa State's bigs, who are more of those bruising types that like to play down on the low block a little bit more.
And they don't score much.
And they don't score much. They're focused more on beating you up inside and providing some protection in there. And so if Coleman can play out on the perimeter in Illinois' five-out lineup and make shots, which I think he's going to get plenty of open shots, pulling those big guys away, and also just off of, you know, skip passes and rotation off of those traps when Dumask has it or when Terrence Shannon's driving, I think Coleman's going to get a lot of shots, especially from three. And he's going to be key, because if he can come out and make some of those, I think that's going to be a guy that can really kind of swing this matchup and where Illinois might have an advantage.
It's weird that you can lay in bed and think about these things, but last night I was thinking of this. I think Coleman Hawkins could be the biggest key to this weekend. And I'm talking not only against Iowa State, but also against UConn. And the big boy for UConn, I never can remember his name.
Donovan Klingon.
Klingon, who is 7'2". He's got the ability to pressure you defensively. He can get out. But yet Coleman Hawkins still is a guy that could take advantage of him in terms of bringing him way out from the basket.
And that's a key, too, because he's probably the best rim protector in the country.
Yep.
And for a guy in Terrence Shannon who does his work around the basket, you want to minimize that big 7'2 wingspan in there trying to deter his shots.
And that's what I was thinking when I thought to myself, and believe me, I'm not – by any means putting the horse before the cart before the horse. I'm not saying that Illinois is automatically through Iowa State, but I think what you just spelled out against Iowa State is a guy like Coleman Hawkins being able to take advantage of their bigs who don't really want to defend on the perimeter, and the idea that he can maybe get to that middle and make things happen. And then, of course, against UConn, being able to bring the big boy out would be huge for Illinois. So
now, I will say the one other thing you have to consider is that probably means you don't play Ty Rogers in that matchup.
Yeah, right.
Because I think ultimately what we've seen here is that if Ty is going to be on the floor, which is Illinois' starting lineup, then bigs are going to hide on him and just kind of roam the paint, yep. And Coleman turns more into a wing.
Isn't it funny how you kind of want to move on to UConn and start figuring out how you would guard them? Who's checking Cam Spencer, the kid from Rutgers, who's, you know, doing this, but yet you can't because you still have an Iowa State team that you have to deal with. You look at Iowa State, they have six guys, 6 guys that average 22 minutes or more for them, and that is kind of how they play it. They're leading minute guy is 31, and a lot of teams' number one minute guy is usually 34 or 35, but that is it Taemin Lipsey? Taemin Lipsey, okay. So he leads him in assists at 5 a game. He leads him in steals as well. Trey King, their leading rebounder, at 5, and Keyshawn Gilbert leads him in points at 14 a game. When you look at their stats, it's boring. But what makes sometimes a team so good is when you have so many different weapons that you can't really just shut down, let's say, Terrence Shannon. Look at Illinois. If you shut down Shannon, well, Illinois would be in trouble if he completely gets shut down. But Marcus Damask can step up. Coleman Hawkins can step up. Guerrier's had games. Luke Goody has come in and had games. Justin Harmon has had games. It looks like for Iowa State, it's just guys that are all kind of right around that 10 to 13-point range. Nobody really busts one out for 20. So it's one of those games where you don't feel like Gilbert or Lipsey is going to just go off for a 20 to 25-point game. And all their rebounding, everybody does the rebounding. There's not one guy that is like 7 or let's say 4 or 5 rebounds average ahead of any other person. And then assist-wise, you got Lipsey and Gilbert both average about 5 and 4 assists. It's just a really good team, Kyle, and that not only on defense, which we've talked about and can learn more as we go, but offensively, when you look at it, it's easy to lull yourself into a, well, this team can't score with Illinois. There's no way that they can maintain what Illinois can maintain. And I think we would all agree with that. Iowa State is not built to score with Illinois, but certainly if their defense does what has done all year, then their ability to spread the wealth, essentially, on offense is what really makes it tough against the Iowa State Cyclones.
Yeah, I totally agree. There's a ton of balance here, although I do think that they kind of have a big three offensively for the most part when you look at Taemin Lipsey, Keyshawn Gilbert, and then their freshman Milan Momcilovic.
Yeah.
I learned how to say that by listening to
Momcilovic?
Momcilovic, I believe, is correct. I so listened like to someone else say it. On a podcast, and that's how I learned how to pronounce it.
I like it. I just assumed it was mom.
Yeah.
But they say it like the Brits say it, mum.
I think. That's how I heard someone else say it. So don't quote me on that, but that's how I'm going to pronounce it. But anyway, I think they have a lot of balance, but I think those three guys are kind of their go-to offensive weapons. I think they all kind of do some different things too. Lipsey Moore, the true point guard, a guy who can break down a defense a little bit, facilitate. Keyshawn Gilbert's probably their best athlete, a guy who, yes, does a lot of his damage around the rim. He's going to try to get downhill, and he's not as much of a shooter. He'll shoot a little bit, but he wants to really get inside and drive. And Momcilovic is probably their best pro prospect. He's got a lot of length. He's more of that wing type who can play kind of at all three levels. So there's balance for sure, and it is a team that I think, like you said, if the game is played at their pace and kind of their style, I think that they have proven that they have enough balance there that, yes, they can score enough and they can complement their defense enough with the guys that they have. But I think Illinois kind of you've got a group here where if Illinois can find the right matchups for these guys and find a way to slow down those three, I think you could see some of, like we saw that 6-minute scoring drought they had against Washington State.
Right.
I think that's going to be key for Illinois, is to really hold them down for stretches of the game for Illinois to try to pull away and get some separation.
I don't remember if it was Hans or who we used to make fun of that he would always say, well, we got to score first when it came to football. Now that was football. Got to get a lead. It would be nice for Illinois to maintain a lead in this thing. and kind of make Iowa State get out of what they like to do. But they're going to be very loyal to what they do for the majority of the game.
Right.
You would have to get up by 15 to 18 points for them to really say, all right, we got to do something different. It's not working. And I just don't see Illinois getting up to that point. But if you can maintain like a 6 to 8 point lead, maybe later in the game they have to feel uncomfortable and get kind of out of what they like to do and hopefully force shots. Curtis Jones actually is their leading three-point getter at 60. He's got 69 on the year. Mumcilovic has 61. Lipsy, 44. Gilbert, 35. So even there shows you how balanced they are when it comes to everything they do on offense. It is interesting when I said I thought Coleman Hawkins could be the key to this weekend. Is there anybody else in your mind? I mean, obviously, Marcus Shannon. You could kind of put them together. Would you agree with that in terms of what Coleman is going to be able to hopefully expose with Iowa State and maybe UConn if you get that far? I'd love to just not say one word about San Diego State and then all of a sudden have to face them.
It'd be a break for sure.
It would be a huge break.
I think that has a low likelihood of happening.
Mm-hmm. Did you see Hurley was, what is it, Danny?
Yeah, everyone's against UConn. Yes. The committee stacking the whole tournament against them.
Which I kind of agree. They got into the toughest bracket when they're the one seed.
At the same time, they've gotten to play at Brooklyn and now Boston.
Yeah.
So, I mean.
But he wasn't happy with the early game. And, yeah, he's just kind of really trying to make this it's the universe against us.
I mean, you got to give him credit. He's finding a way to make his team think that the best team in the country that has rightfully been called the best team in the country is getting slighted.
Yeah.
And that might be giving them the edge they need to win the whole thing.
Great.
It's great coaching, even though you roll your eyes at it.
Totally agree. But you do agree, though, with Coleman in terms of that notion?
Yes, I think Coleman's going to be huge because when he has been aggressive on offense and when he has really been that true number three complementary piece to what Shannon and Damask are bringing offensively, that's when Illinois has been at their best. And I think there's going to be so much focus placed on stopping Shannon and stopping Damask that Coleman Hawkins is going to have an opportunity to make a big impact on offense. And I think both of these theoretical matchups are going to be ones where he is really kind of that swing piece in the matchup where he's so versatile and he's so unique in what he's able to do that these opposing bigs are going to be taken out of their comfort zone a little bit, and Iowa State's kind of going to need to find a way to adjust to that. And his three-point shooting, I think, is going to be massive, especially in this particular game against Iowa State, a team who gives up a lot of threes. And like we mentioned with the matchup with their bigs, I think Coleman's probably going to get 7, 8, 9 open looks from three.
Agreed. Totally.
And if he can make 4 or 5 of those, that might be the difference in the game.
That'd be huge. All right, I want to go through the U of I Line of Lake text line. We have a few texts coming in today. We'll get a break. We'll come back. We'll hear what Brad Underwood had to say. Who am I trying to think of that is the main guy for Big Ten Network?
Dave Revson.
Thank you. Dave Revson, who grew up in Urbana. So, sorry, Dave. Good guy. He's been on our show before, friend of the program. So, apologies to Dave Revson. I'm just old now, and I forgot his name. So, Matt said early we were talking about maybe not having Piper as part of the name on the show anymore because we hope we don't see him for 3 weeks. But Matt still said change the name to Piper and Kyle. Matt, he did put the smiley, what do you call those, emoji, the laughing emoji. Yeah, that's fine. Do you need your name first, though? Kyle and Pipes?
I
kind of like that.
Yeah.
Kyle and Pipes. I'll do the voiceover.
Again, let's not curse this run that we're on here.
Right.
By getting my name on there.
Like, I can't wait to be the full, like, I want to be Matt Carpenter, where I just come in and fill in on occasion on the Kyle and Pipes
show. Once a week,
you
pinch hit.
And I'd complain about it. I'd get here and I'd be like, man, I had to work today and this stinks. And Maxwell said Lon's trying to turn Kyle into the Steve Bartman of Illinois basketball by changing the name, and then Illinois immediately loses. We talked a little Cardinals baseball, the fact that half their roster's hurt and they're going to start the season with two guys in the outfield. Scott said apathy is set in for Cards fans, not wasting money to go to St. Louis until they really try to win playoff games again. I truly didn't. Late in the season, I would have told you I'm not going to watch that game. They're horrible. right? But that wasn't the reason I didn't get down there. I was just so busy with Andrew's stuff that I never really had a chance to get down to a game, and I am kind of frustrated and kind of ashamed of myself, seriously, for not trying to get down there and get that done. So I do want to get to a couple of Cardinals games this year. Anthony, back to Illinois basketball. Live ball turnovers leading to runouts is the killer. How come every time I start to read that, it changes? Marcus seems to have those at inopportune times. And I agree with that. And we touched on that, that Marcus DeMass, sometimes you find him. And listen, it's all about the booty ball. When you're booty balling people, that's when you're dribbling, because you're dribbling them down essentially to a spot on the court then where you're comfortable at getting a shot and or a layup. But that has been an issue. And if Marcus doesn't watch out, he's going to be double teamed. Excuse me. And the ball could be taken away. So that is something that you'll have to watch for and look out for as this game goes along. Wes says he's heard it, Mumchilovich.
That could be right.
Okay. I think Luke Goody just calls him mama's boy. I think he just, from the tip, every time he touches it, Goody's on the sideline, and then when he's in the game, he's like, what's up, mama's boy? What's up, mama's boy? That's what he does. Kyler, I think one thing that benefits us with their style of trapping and getting into rotations, we should be able to really dominate on the offensive glass. That's a good call.
Yes, I think the one other thing to mention in this matchup, and it's an important thing, is the two weaknesses of this Iowa State defense, and that really comes with any team who's really aggressive like they are. They're not great on the defensive glass, and they foul a lot.
Yes.
And that, I think, will be a huge key for Illinois, is if they can get on the offensive glass and if they can offensive rebound. Ty Rogers, Quincy Guerrier, Coleman Hawkins can offensive rebound and get some second chances. I think that'll be huge. And then also, if Illinois can really attack and try to draw fouls and get some of those guys in foul trouble, I think that those are the two paths to success offensively for Illinois, and they do align with two of Illinois' biggest strengths. So I think it could come to play.
That's a great point, and I want to hear that again tomorrow, because I like that. And I think Illinois, we know, can do damage on the glass. So that's something that Brad Underwood has kind of really, since he got into coaching. I know his Stephen F. Austin teams were always really good on the glass. I think the one year he was at Oklahoma State, they seemed to be solid on the glass. And most of the years he's been at Illinois, the Illini have been the better rebounding team normally, night in and night out. I paused there while you were talking because I just saw that AJ Storr has sent a message out to Wisconsin fans. It's a long one. It's one of those. But essentially he said, I've decided to engage and experience the NBA draft process all while maintaining my college eligibility. And then at the very end, he says, the memories, lessons, and friendships I've made here, which would be Wisconsin, will forever be part of who I am. Thank you, Badger Nation, for everything. With all my heart, AJ Storr. So let me read through that to you, Kyle, because you're young and maybe you haven't been experienced on Twitter like I have. He's gone. AJ Storr will not be with the Wisconsin Badgers next season.
I would tend to agree with you. All I'll say is that Terrence Shannon and Coleman Hawkins both said thank you, Illini Nation, last year and came back. So in this day and age, I mean, you post the thank you graphic and really anything can still happen.
I just don't sense him in a Wisconsin.
I agree with you in his particular case. I'd be surprised if he plays at Wisconsin.
You're right. That was a good comeback there for that. All right, Brad Underwood met today with the Big – no, it was yesterday, I think, with the Big Ten Network, or last night or something. And we're going to hear that. It was a good interview. I was able to catch most of it today. So we'll hear from Brad Underwood next hour. At the bottom of the hour, Brett Bielema had another conversation with the media. So we're going to hear from Brett. Any other – I know that Jacobs, the running back, right? Josh.
Josh McCray.
McCray. Josh Jacobs. Was he a running back for, like, the Giants?
Josh Jacobs.
Or no, Raiders.
Raiders, yeah. And he now just signed with the Packers.
Okay, he was the guy that I wanted in fantasy and couldn't get him, and now he haunts me to this day on the radio show where I call Josh McCray Josh Jacobs. I did tell you, and you will attest to this, yesterday, I said, you know what, I would like to hear from McCray, because Josh...
He's pretty short.
Is it? But he's a guy that came on, like, a warrior his freshman season, and then he's been hurt since. if you can get him running at full tilt along with Caden Fagan, those are two powerful backs. Now, it'd be nice to have that, and hopefully Valentine is that guy that can provide the speed that you need. But
still got Aiden Loffrey in the mix as well.
The local kids. So hopefully that – but, man, if you've got two battering rams and Jacobs and Fagan
– you call him Jacobs dang it, again.
In McCray and Fagan. See, Josh Jacobs is just awning me. I'm drafting him number one this year. Not number one overall, unless I have it. In the first round, I'm drafting Josh Jacobs, and I'm going to call him McCray the entire NFL season. All right, let's get to this. Please help me out here. On the go over spring break, bank on your schedule with Busey's mobile app and Money Pass. Two ways Busey makes your banking hassle-free. Through the Money Pass network, easily access surcharge-free ATMs. There's 37,000-plus ATMs nationwide. That includes nearly 3,400 in Illinois, Indiana, Missouri, and Florida. There's no need to sign up and no fee to participate as long as you have a Busey debit card. To take advantage of the savings and locate a Money Pass ATM near you, look for the Money Pass logo or visit locations and hours on Busey.com. And of course, if you download the Busey mobile app, you can view balances, transfer funds, pay your bills. You could pay Kyle. You can deposit checks directly from your mobile device. They make it convenient, they save you time, and they make it safe and secure. That's what Busey does. From surcharge-free ATMs to the Busey mobile app and beyond, Busey keeps you connected to your accounts from coast to coast. Visit Busey.com for a complete look at their mobile and online banking services. Busey, member FDIC.
This is Eddie Clare, president of Paul's. Are you looking for a career and not just a job? Paul's is looking for experienced fabricators and millwrights to join our team on both first and second shifts. We have a great benefit package, including 2 weeks of paid vacation from day one, a company bonus, health, vision, dental for you and for your family, a 401k with a match. We also offer tuition reimbursement and on-the-job training programs for less experienced fabricators and millwrights. Let Paul's create big possibilities for you, your career, and your life. Apply online at PaulsMachine.com.
You have money laying all around your house. You just don't know it. And no, I don't mean selling your great-grandma's good china. I mean all the old metal items you don't want to use or get rid of. Don't pay someone to haul it away. Bring it into Max Twin City Recycling and get paid to have it taken off your hands. They love new customers and are more than willing to walk you through their process step by step. Come check them out at 2808 North Lincoln Avenue in Urbana.
It seems like the cost of everything is on the rise, but Erie Insurance can help make sure your auto insurance premium isn't one of them. Avoid rate increases with Erie Rate Lock. Even if you have a claim, your rates won't go up until you change a car, driver, or address.
Your Erie agent in Champaign is Thomas and Eller's Insurance.
Erie Rate Lock is not available in all states. Other conditions and limitations at ErieInsurance.com. Go to ErieInsurance.com for company licensure and product details.
Don't miss out when Ancient Aliens Live lands in a town near you. The Out of This World Tour continues with 15 new dates announced across the country. Hear from the experts of Ancient Aliens live and in person.
All of you are on this journey with all of us together.
Get your tickets now at AncientAliensLiveTour.com.
Ancient Aliens Live, Project Earth, lands in the Virginia Theater Friday, March 29th. Tickets on sale now at thevirginia.org.
By now, you've all heard the expression, when you turn the key and the car won't run, call 367-9481 for PDR Automotive. They are what's best for your truck or car. They are PDR. But who are they? They, the PDR staff, understand that a name is only as good as the people that represent it. The PDR staff has more than 335 years of combined automotive experience, several employees now on staff for more than 25 years. PDR, more than just a name. Family owned and operated, now celebrating over 50 years in business.
Since Busey Bank first opened our doors in 1868, we have built upon a tradition of close relationships and broad financial capabilities. Our experienced team provides the highest level of personalized service to ensure we accomplish your goals, simplifying your wealth management and business lending needs, and ensuring a legacy for generations. building business, growing wealth since 1868. Proud to be the official bank of the Fighting Illini. Member FDIC.
At ABC Heating and Air, it's our promise to help you always be comfortable. Do you need rescued because you're burning hot? Do you need rescued because your air is shot? Call ABC Heating and Air at 352-5400 and let us rescue you from the heat. ABC Heating and Air, 352-5400. Can't you see you need to call me at ABC? Call ABC Heating and Air. That's ABC Heating and Air, 352-5400.
The average American throws away almost 5 pounds of trash per day, half which ends up in a landfill. At 2 Men in a Junk Truck, when we pick up your unwanted furniture, appliances, trash, and office equipment, we make it a priority to divert those items from your local landfill. 2 Men in a Junk Truck, looking for partners that share our vision of environmental responsibility. If you and your organization can reuse, upcycle, recycle some of these items, we would love to work with you. Contact us at 2menandajunktruck.com. We want to make room for what matters most.
Our big stat is brought to you by Gatorade. Illinois left no doubt this weekend. Two convincing wins, including a 26-point pounding of Duquesne on Saturday night that was never in doubt, a game in which they never trailed. The 26-point margin, the fourth largest in school history in the NCAA tournament, largest ever in a non-first-round game. And that segues us beautifully into our big interview. As promised, it's the head coach of the Fighting Illini, Brad Underwood, who is with us. Coach, congratulations on a fabulous weekend. What did you like most about the way your team played over those two games?
Well, thanks, Dave. I loved our after our 9-0 start we gave Moorhead. We played pretty good after that. I thought we were – we were really good against Duquesne. We got on them early. We did it in a variety of ways. We did it with our defense and then transition. We did it with Coleman Hawkins stepping out and hitting three threes in a row in pick and pop situations. All in all, I thought it was, Dane Deja was phenomenal. Obviously Marcus with a triple double. But, we kind of took what the defenses gave us and found a way to exploit it.
I know it's not your end goal at all, but we have uttered the fact that Illinois hasn't been to the second weekend since 2005, honestly, more times than I can count, probably since the network launched. What does it mean to you to silence that, to get to the point now where we don't have to think about that anymore?
Yeah, I'm happy for our fans. I'm happy for the program. This program is so good and it's been so good. It's so important to everybody. We sell out every game. Nobody travels like us. Our fans are fabulous when we travel. It's really quite remarkable that it's been that long. Personally, I'm very, very happy for the program, for our fans, for, our administration. It was going to end sooner or later. My goal was always just keep getting there. And you get there, good things can happen. And we made that happen this past weekend.
I think back to when you took over the program, Brad, it just wasn't in a good spot. I mean, they hadn't made the tournament in 4 years. You kind of started from scratch with a new group, and it took a couple years to get there, a couple lean years. When you think personally about the journey that you've been through with this program to get here, what flashes through your mind?
Yeah, no shortcuts. I think we did it, pre-portal. We built it. We did it with starting from the ground floor. We wanted to make sure our culture was right. We're a development program. It's based on hard work. It's based on guys wanting to come in and work and get better. We saw that development. It started with an Io DeSumo and Andres Felice, a Kofi Coburn, Trent Frazier, DeMonte Williams, a group of guys that I couldn't be happier for them. They've all reached out and they're ecstatic at what they built. And, I don't think there was any shortcuts and then we've tried to stay very consistent, with that whole philosophy since day one.
One of the things that I think is really cool about you as a coach is how much you've adapted. And I would just say that this team, the way you play offensively and the way you play defensively, bears almost no resemblance to when you got there. And there was a great article in The Athletic yesterday talking about Jay Wright and how he had given you some advice during the course of this year that caused you to alter a little bit of how you're playing this year, mid-year. Like, fill people in on that and kind of your philosophy of being willing to adapt your style, because I do think it's unusual.
Yeah, I don't want to be stubborn. I want to do what's best for the players that we have. And sometimes it requires change. And, you know, we were turning the ball over. We knew we had a really good player in Marcus Demosque who, you know, was kind of floundering about 8-9 points a game. And you know, we needed to open the court with Terrence a little more and do some different things. And we found a way. And I mean, you know, I say it all the time, we start 5 power forwards. And we needed to find a way to make that work. And lo and behold, we got the number one offense in the country. And it's just putting guys in positions to,
you're one. You're number one. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And it's just finding guys, finding a way to play that suits the personnel you have. And me kind of trying to figure that out and get out of my own way sometimes and not overcomplicate things.
You and I were talking during the Big Ten tournament. You came over to our desk in between games and we were just chatting really quickly. And you said something to me. You said, I'm having a great time coaching this team. Like, this is such a fun group to be around. And I think we saw evidence of it the other night when you went into the locker room with the squirt gun and bombarded the guys. Give me a sense of why. Like, what's so much fun about this group aside from the obvious that you're winning?
Yeah, and it doesn't have it's not because we're winning that I'm having fun. It's because of who these guys are, and they play the right way. They play for the joy of the game in a time where it's NIL this and this, and our guys are doing, you know, they're all getting NIL, and that's great, and I'm for that. But they play for the passion and the love of the game, and it hurts them when we lose. They work so hard, and they stand for all the right things, and they genuinely love each other. I mean, we don't have any bickering. We don't have any team stuff. They just have a great time together. And I've always been a guy that I think you have to reward winning. You have to acknowledge it. It's really, really hard to do. And so we've always done that here. You know, after every game, I celebrate winning. The other night, it was just nice to take the Super Soaker and give a little back to them because of all the water I've received over the years. So we had a little fun with that.
I have noticed there's been a trend of drenched coaches. So the drenched players, as you say, it's a little bit of a role reversal. You were talking about having the number one offense in the country, which you do. Andy and I were discussing your matchup with Iowa State a little bit earlier. I mean, it literally is the number one offense against the number one defense. You think about it, we're 360-plus teams in Division I college basketball to get that matchup. I mean, what are the odds for that? I know you started studying Iowa State at least a little bit. Give us some insight into what makes them so good defensively.
Well, TJ does an unbelievable job, and the reason they're good is they play really, really hard. They'll play as hard as any team in the country. But they're very, very sound in their scheme. They know exactly what TJ wants them to do, and then they do it at a very, very high rate. And they're aggressive, they're handsy, they're very physical. They're running through passing lanes, taking stuff away. They're tenacious. They're not an overly deep team. They play 7 or 8 guys, but they're committed to it. And TJ's got to play in very hard.
Well, they're playing really well, but you're playing really well also. I won't ask you about the rest of the region with UConn and San Diego State other than to say no favors were done. But, I mean, look, that's the NCAA tournament this year, right? And we've had most of the favorites win here, so you know it's going to be a tough road to get to Phoenix.
Yeah, I mean, you've got it the other side. You've got a preview of the, you know, Final Four last year in the championship game, and obviously everybody's number one in UConn. Deservedly so. But that's the beauty of this tournament. You know, you're going to have to win six games against really good opponents, and winning's really hard. And every game you have to go out and be your best. And it's nice to know we're playing well, and we're playing our best, and we're healthy. So let's throw it up and see where it falls.
Cannot wait to watch you guys coming up later this week. I hope the next time we talk, it's in Phoenix, Brad. That would be awesome.
Day, that'd make my day. I hope you're right. Go Big Ten.
All right, man. Great to talk to you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
That is Brad Underwood. The Illinois women's team also kept their season alive over the weekend. Adalia McKenzie, a career-high 28. They topped Stony Brook in the second round of the WBIT. They will battle Tulsa Thursday in the quarterfinals.
There you go. The Illini women, Shauna Green, of course, now over 500 as a coach. And will finish at least 500 or better for a second straight season. Of course, a really good year last year. So hopefully that will continue to go in the right direction. Maybe a little bit of a hiccup this season, but certainly this is a team that's kind of taken advantage of that WNIT and gotten things done. I think Ohio State's still going in the NIT, the men's NIT.
That's correct.
Here's another thing I thought about today, and I hope that I'm absolutely never in this spot to where we have to talk about it on the show, but if Illinois ever was in that position again, the men, where they had to make a decision, because I know a lot of people took a lot of grief this season about not playing in the NIT. Who was it that went off? Was that Tom Crean?
Yeah, it was.
That went off kind of because Indiana decided not to play in the NIT. And I thought to myself, well, it's easy to rip Indiana and teams that say no to the NIT. But then you say, okay, well, hold on a second. Put it into my realm. Would I be excited? Now, listen, if SIU didn't make the NCAA tournament, then I do want them to play in the NIT. I think that's fun. I feel like that's, you know, hell, they won it back in 67 when it was the bigger tournament than the NCAA, basically. But now it's not. It's not even close. So I would love that with the Salukis. And by the way, somebody asked me, oh, Nick, are you hearing anything on the SIU coaching front? I'm not. The only rumors that keep flying around is that a plane from Lexington, Kentucky into Marion, airport has happened a couple of times. So maybe Chin, maybe Orlando wanting to get back in the coaching front.
Kentucky's buying out Coach Cal and he's going to coach the Salukis.
Let's go. Let's see what we got. Put us into absolute trouble with the NCAA after you get to the tournament about three straight years. And then I'm fine with whatever happened. No, I'm kidding. Don't do that. I don't think it would be Cal, but and listen, I'm guessing Brian Mullins didn't make as much as Chin Coleman. And Brian made a decent amount, I guess, on that. I did see today a kind of a cool story.
Brian Mullins coaching with Chris Holtman, yes, at DePaul now.
Yeah, so he didn't go up in salary, but I'm sure he's getting a decent salary at DePaul. I saw something today that Indiana State last year had an NIL number of. Well, you want to guess? Now, this is Indiana State, a team that a lot of people thought should make the NCAA tournament. Had Rob, what is it, Avila or Avila or whatever it is, the big guy that's kind of, I was hoping would be kind of the storyline for a lot of NCAA stuff, but it didn't happen. So what would you say?
Meaning just like their total NIL budget as a program, basically?
For basketball.
I'll say they had like $200,000 something.
I think it was $30,000.
Wow.
So what I read today is that Indiana State has to get their NIL number up to 90,000 to keep a lot of the guys from last season.
Makes sense.
But isn't that crazy? Like 30? That can't be right.
I would be shocked. But
I mean, you would think it would be more than
that's
that.
That's what a lot of these mid-major programs are dealing with.
Yeah.
You got high major teams that have budgets pushing a million into the millions.
Right.
There's plenty that are above seven figures. And so it's just so hard to compete. And it's even like for some of those guys that just came off the year that they had, you look at a Robbie Avila who's got one more year left. Why would 90,000 do it? Like he could probably get 500,000 from somebody the way things have gone. So
I totally agree with you.
Yeah, it's just a tough spot for a lot of those schools to be in.
I agree. And guys like Damask and Lance Jones and Rink Mass certainly proved to a lot of people that going from the Valley to the Big Ten can work. So we'll see. We'll see what happens on that. But, yeah, I had read something today on that, and I'm like, man, that doesn't even make sense. Scott said Indiana State again tonight. So they play tonight again.
Yeah, they play Cincinnati in the NIT.
I know they had a big deal in Terre Haute Sunday. I almost went over. They had kind of a – oh, it's 4 o'clock. I just noticed. Kyle's like giving me the yeah line. They had a big deal in Terre Haute. I thought about going over and just wearing my Saluki gear and being like, hey, I'm rooting for the Sycamores. All right, let's take a break. We'll hear some football stuff next hour. There's a new kickoff being proposed in the NFL. I want your thoughts on it. We'll get to that and more next. It is The Drive.
Are you ready? A free trip to the most lavish resort out of this world. The most spectacular landscapes and majestic views ever imagined. Where all human pains, afflictions, worries, concerns, they'll all be gone for eternity. You're right. It will be heaven. Well, it is very simple. Start your journey today. The Lord opens His welcoming arms to greet you. And this week, visit His house. Attend church services of your choice. We have found the Lord at Muhammad Christian Church. Listen to the words. Jesus will guide you as to where you need to be. And for our friends in nursing homes or assisted living, please attend your weekly prayer services. It is that simple. Start your journey today. The Lord will put His arm around you and give you comfort. Take away all your problems, anxieties, and pains for eternity. Are you ready? The Lord has been expecting you.
You're listening to WSJK ESPN 93.5 Tuscola, Champaign-Urbana, your home for the St. Louis Cardinals.
Are you over 30 and putting off life insurance? It's time to get a quick quote from Ethos, a better, easier way to get term life insurance. All online with no medical exam. Answer a few health questions and you could be approved for up to $2 million. Isn't it worth 10 minutes to help protect your family's financial security? Ethos, up to $2 million in coverage with no medical exam. Some policies as low as $1 a day. Answer a few health questions and get your free quote at checkethos.com. That's checkethos.com.
Do you find yourself stuck in a timeshare? Get the real facts about the timeshare industry and your options for cancellation. Chuck McDell, founder of Wesley Financial Group, has put together a free information guide that reveals the secrets the timeshare industry doesn't want you to know, including the 5 ways to get rid of your timeshare. Call now and get this timeshare information guide absolutely free. Call 800-919-3200. That's 800-919-3200. 800-919-3200.
The fight over an abortion pill goes to the U.S. Supreme Court, hearing arguments over FDA decisions about the drug, including changes that expanded access.
The Alliance for Hippocratic Medicine sued the FDA, saying their rule changes making it easier to get abortion drug mifepristone violated the law. But Supreme Court justices like Elena Kagan heavily questioned the group's attorney, Aaron Hawley, about whether the group even had standing or proper legal cause to sue. Hawley said, yeah, one client, a doctor, had to perform a procedure on a woman after she'd taken mifepristone.
She herself performed that.
That is correct.
And did she have an opportunity to object? Did she object?
No, Your Honor. Again, these are life-threatening situations.
The Biden administration's Solicitor General argued the real harm here would be to the drug approval process and women if the justices do not side with the FDA. Jessica Rosenthal, Fox News.
A day after setting the date for the former president's first criminal trial in a hush money-related case, the judge in New York issues a gag order, banning him from commenting on witnesses, prosecutors, court staff, or jurors. A good first day of trading for shares of the former president's social media company, which runs his social media platform, Truth Social, the stock jumping more than 50% during its NASDAQ debut under ticker symbol DJT, his initials, closing up 16%.
So this stock is really defying the logic, because based on the share price, it's worth somewhere between $9 and $10 billion right now. And analysts are arguing this doesn't represent the underlying business. It has under 5 million users. It lost $49 million in the first 9 months of last year. And actually, a really great comparison is Reddit. That's also a social media company. It's similarly priced in the market, actually below DJT right now. It IPO'd last week. It generates 160 times more revenue than Trump Media last year.
Fox Business's Kelly O'Grady. Overall, back-to-back losses on Wall Street, the Dow dropping 31 points. I'm Lisa Brady, Fox News.
Hello again, everyone. Let's check weather. Freeze on Florida. Champagne and Van Nevis Saturday. Most of the organized rains of yesterday. Well off to the north and east of us. Still a stout wind pattern. New activity in the form of scattered showers. A couple of thunderstorms making their way across the western end of the state. They'll be in here as the morning wears on. Meanwhile, winter storm conditions through the upper Midwest, western Great Lakes region. A bit of a break in this active weather pattern over the end part of the week. And by early next week, we're back into the thick of it with more widespread rains. Temperatures for the day today into the 50s. They'll fall back in the mid to upper 40s this afternoon, though, and towards evening time, with southwesterly winds gusting still to 40 to 45 miles per hour. That wind will diminish here slowly later on tonight, down to a colder low of 31, tomorrow partly sunny 47. Back into the 50s with sunshine Thursday, 64 on Good Friday, and over the Easter holiday weekend, what's left of it, 65. Stray shower chance Saturday, some rain late in the day on Sunday, Easter high 58. Showers and thunderstorms Monday next week, we pop back into the 60s. For CVJ Broadcasting, I'm meteorologist Greg Solier.
It is The Drive, ESPN Radio 93.5, The Drive with Tay and Piper. We just, I was doing some Google Map work at the break. Kyle Toss, by the way, in for Derek Piper today and for the rest of the month, it sounds like, because Illinois is
we hope, right.
We're going to continue to keep trucking towards that Final Four and hopefully the national championship. 217 said, I found it interesting that the Iowa State player, that would be Milan Muncilovic, with the odd name, was a Wisconsin Mr. Basketball, as was Marcus Damask. I suppose they both wanted to play as freshmen. Yeah, Damask, of course, ended up going to SIU and was the player of the year in Wisconsin, and that is the case with Muncilovic. I was just looking on Google Maps. Muncilovic is from a town called Pewaukee, which is right outside of Milwaukee. I guess that makes sense now that I know the two names. And then, of course, Damask is from Wappan, which is Wisconsin, which is kind of in the heart of the state of Wisconsin. So there you go. Geography covered. Let the bell ring. That class is over. It's time for PE. That's what I always loved back in the day. All right. I had to do some fact checking because I was completely wrong, not even close. Anybody that's listened to the show for 14 years will be like, yeah, well, we didn't believe you anyway, Lon. So I did a fact check.
Just like Jacobs, the Illinois running back.
Hey, that's an honest mistake there, right? So last season, Indiana State's basketball NIL revenue, or essentially budget, was a little bit more than $90,000, not $30,000. So $90,000 is what it was. They are now saying that they need to get that up to $300,000 threshold to keep a lot of the players that were there last year. Now it makes more sense.
Makes a lot more sense.
For Kyle and I, as Kyle said, why would the big boy only play for $90,000? And, of course, they've got more than him. I mean, they've got some really good players on that Indiana State team who I still believe should have been in the NCAA tournament. So when you've got Virginia in there, who obviously used their opposite hand to shoot all night, I can't explain how else you would lose and score 40 points or whatever. But
and they rubbed off on Colorado State too,
who then scored
like 30 the next time they when they played Texas. Virginia is a disease.
It is. Virginia's a disease. All right, Kyle and I are going to – tomorrow could be really busy for us here. Tim Onstott is bringing his huge trailer. What did Diane say? It's like a 70-foot trailer.
Mm-hmm.
Tim Onstott, of course, he manages Dedicated Diesel and Gale Frerichs Trucking, but he's also one of the best barbecue pitmasters in the country. Like, he went down to Mississippi, I think, and won a battle versus a bunch of Southern guys – in barbecue. He is bringing his trailer tomorrow to Philo and is making brisket, ribs, pulled pork, I assume, chicken, barbecue chicken. I'm not eating. In fact, I won't eat starting now until tomorrow at like 2:30. And he is going to feed Kyle and I, Pipes, who's going to miss this one. I'm bringing like a doggy bag. In fact, I may call Doggy Bag in Muhammad and say, there's going to be so much food, I need you to drop off one of your doggy bags here. Because, Stevie even said, bring a to-go box. Because I remember we did this a couple of years ago at our old location there on Windsor in Urbana. And there was so much food left at the end, it was ridiculous. And it was so good that I ate barbecue for like six straight days. Like, I literally got to the point where I'm like, I do not want another thing of barbecue for a month. And I like barbecue. So it was just really, I just cannot wait. So Tim will be here. You and I are going to test this food and make comments throughout the show like this. You know, I mean, it's not like.
I'm sure people will just absolutely love that.
So I'll bring a case of beer and a case of water for Kyle. Because he's not 21. No, I'm kidding. But I cannot wait to eat some of this barbecue tomorrow. And really appreciate Tim for coming because it's going to be great. I know that Corey Witt, Jason Thompson, who come and fill in for you and Pipes when you guys are gone, I welcomed them to come along around 4 o'clock. And I said, why don't you guys join us for a half hour? We'll have some fun. We'll talk some Illinois basketball. And then you guys can just eat for an hour. Essentially, and they're both like, yeah, we'll be there. So I think they're coming, and we think we're going to have Luke Goody, Sean Harrington, and Derek Piper on tomorrow. We know for sure we're having Piper, probably at 4:30, and then it appears that Goody will be at some point tomorrow. Probably, if I had to guess, early in the show, in the first hour, maybe right off the top, and then Sean Harrington, our old buddy who played with the Illini and went deep in the NCAA tournament, Sean is going to join us. He thinks he can do that tomorrow, and I was thinking around 3:30 there. So it's going to be really busy. So what we thought we would do today is kind of go through the games and give kind of our predictions on what we expect to happen the next 2 days, not into the weekend, but certainly, especially now, Kyle, that we did our initial bracket, right? Mm-hmm. And you and I are still in pretty good shape.
Yeah, my Final Four is still alive. Everything before that is
correct.
I tried to get too. That's the problem is you try to get too cute with these upsets, and then this year it's all chalk. And so the people that are just like, well, let me pick 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 seed to move on are probably leading the bracket pools. Well, you know, you're trying to get cute about it. But
you're right. And the thing that really you fear about this season with this is like 95% of the people had UConn winning it.
Yeah.
So it's not like if you had UConn winning, you're basically tied with everybody else for the final points of the tournament. So you better figure out a way from either now until the championship game to catch up, unless, of course, Illinois beats UConn to get to the Final Four, which I'd be okay with because that means they will have beaten Iowa State and then UConn.
I will gladly rip my bracket up for Illinois knocking UConn out.
Be incredible. Let's start in the West. You've got North Carolina and Alabama. Here's what I want. Now, obviously, you're going to be enjoying every one of these games. I mean, let's be honest. There's 16 games. They're all going to be pretty good. But, Kyle, give me like a 1 through 10, your excitement level of watching these games. And then let's talk about who we think will win that game. So you got one seed in the West. That is North Carolina advancing. They beat Michigan State 85-69. Advancing to face Alabama. the four seed. So it went chalk there, 1-4. I think my temperature for this game to watch it is maybe a 5. And that's too bad because Carolina, Alabama will make this an exciting game. They'll get up and down the court. Let me rephrase it. I'm going to go 6 in terms of excitement level on this one. And I'll take Carolina to advance again.
I would probably be at about an 8. I think okay. This is actually going to be an entertaining game. It's two really explosive offensive teams. The point guard battle, RJ Davis and Mark Sears, two of the best point guards in the country going at it, I think will be fun. I also think it's going to be up and down at an unbelievable pace. I think winner of this game probably gets 95 points.
Woo.
So I think it will be a very entertaining game. Unfortunately, it's the one game that overlaps with Illinois, so probably won't have a close eye on it. But I think it should be a great game. I am going to ride with North Carolina as well. I think they just have more depth than Bama, and they're the better overall team. And I think RJ Davis is a slightly better guard there, so I'll go with the Heels.
Now, earlier tomorrow night, Clemson, the 6th seed, will face number 2, Arizona. I have some, like, I need Arizona to make the Final Four. They're one of my Final Four teams. So I'd say I'm probably a 7 in terms of watching this. I was interested on what Clemson did to Baylor. I want to see Kylan Boswell. I haven't really put eyes on him since early in the season, and I know he's doing pretty well for Arizona. So I've got a couple of things. And then a person I know who I happen to be related to, they bought Arizona in one of the brackets. This is kind of a cool thing. You buy your team, and the way you make money is if whoever you're playing, if you beat that team, you get their money. Does that make sense, Kyle?
Yes.
So if Clemson went for 300 and you paid, let's say, 800 for Arizona, then if Arizona beats Clemson, you get their 300. And that's how you start racking up your cash. So I'm gonna pull for Arizona for that reason, but also because I've got him in the Final Four. Mm-hmm. And I want to see Kylan Boswell. I want to see him, the former, of course, Urbana native kid that I guess shunned Illinois, right? I mean, you could say that. It didn't get ugly or anything, but certainly that was something that he chose to do. Wasn't he already at a prep school in Arizona?
Yes.
So he was out there, and listen, I've visited Arizona a few times when Lucas was in school, and I kind of like Arizona, so I'd probably stay there too. I'd probably a 7 on this one, and I am going to go Arizona to beat Clemson. I think this is a nice draw for Arizona.
I agree with you. I'm probably more down at a 4 or 5 for this one. I just think Clemson's road ends here. I think they're going to be overmatched in this game. I think it could – Arizona's such a volatile team that if they just show up and don't make shots that it could get interesting. But I just think the caliber difference in this game is probably one of the bigger in this Sweet 16. And I think Arizona, if they play how they're capable, should be able to take care of Clemson here. So and that is my prediction. I think we're getting ready for that North Carolina-Arizona battle, which when you talk about watchability for that one, that's a 10 on
Caleb
Saturday
Love.
Night if that one happens.
Wade just texted in the U of I Lightning Lake text line and said, I want to see North Carolina and Arizona. I'm going to zip to the south now for a couple of reasons that I want to save the east region, and there's a big game in the Midwest that Kyle and I are kind of going head-to-head on. So I want to keep that till kind of the end. In the South, the early game Friday night will be NC State and Marquette. My watchability on this is a 2. I have zero interest in this thing.
Yep.
And I will take Marquette to beat NC State. Marquette will have then beat 11 seed. No, I'm sorry. Hold on. Let me 15, start over.
15, 10, 11.
To get to an Elite Eight. That's a pretty nice path for the
I'd
Golden
say
Eagles.
So.
So, yeah, like a 2, it might even be a 1. Like, I know that I'm supposed to jump on the cool story that is the Wolfpack and how they've really, you know, they won the ACC tournament and now they've kind of just caught fire here in this tournament, beating Texas Tech by 13. And then they, of course, knocked off Oakland, who had surprised Kentucky. So, I'm just going to go Marquette in this one, like in a, I'll say an 8-point win, and I don't care to watch it.
Yeah, on a relative scale compared to the rest of the Sweet 16, this is a 1. This is the one I'm least excited for. I think Marquette is going to win this game pretty handily here. NC State wasn't anywhere close to the tournament a week ago. And then they won 5 games in 5 days ACC tournament and have played great here recently. Give them credit. But You know, they beat Oakland last round in a game where if Oakland can draw up a better last-second possession, maybe they're not even here and lose to a 14. I just think Marquette's so much better than this team, and I think it'll play out that way.
The game that I'd like to see, and I'll definitely record it and have to watch it because there's another game that's going to be going on at that time that Kyle and I are going to be staring down each other. But in the South as well is number one, Houston going against Duke. That thing stayed chalk there. Duke has played really well. I was shocked at how they handled James Madison. But there again, they've beaten a 13 and a 12. But now all of a sudden reality smacks you in your face against a Houston team that we talk all about Houston and their defense. Kyle, they've scored 86 and 100. Now, granted, the 100 was an OT. But it's amazing that they've really pushed that offense up, and their defense, of course, they gave up 46 in the first and then 95 to A&M. I know Duke's hot, but I'm going to go with Houston here. I'm going to go with the pedigree of Houston to get past that and set up a chalk 1-2 against Marquette in the South.
Yep, I agree with you there. I think Duke, in both the games they played against North Carolina was so physical, and they just kind of – you know, back down and just didn't put up much of a fight physically. Talk about the most physical team in college basketball. Houston, I think, is going to beat this Duke team up. And I just really like the matchup for Houston here. I am intrigued to watch it, though, with the way Duke has played and some of their stars. I'd be at about an 8 in terms of interest in this game. But I do think Houston will find a way to get it done.
Sounds good. Let's go to the Midwest. The first game of the night, Purdue and Gonzaga. This is a Gonzaga team that has looked good and wins over McNeese, who a lot of people kind of had McNeese as that team that could win a game or two. Of course, I was one of them, so then I say a lot of people. Probably nobody else did. And then they beat Kansas 89-68, just blew out the Jayhawks in round two. Now they get Purdue. I just don't see them stopping Purdue. I feel like this is Final Four or bust for Purdue. I'm going Purdue to win that. Watchability, I forgot to say that on Duke-Houston, that's like an 8 for me. On that game, watchability for Purdue Gonzaga would be maybe a 7. I think Gonzaga can give them a battle for a while. Lucas the other day texted me and he goes, "I just shut the Purdue game off. I can't stand watching them because the officials."
I agree
with Edie. He's like, "I literally just shut it off." I'm like,
"Totally agree."
Well, if you're just gonna get mad at it, learn from your old man. And where I never shut it off, at least learn from me and just shut it off, and your night's a lot better. I'll take Purdue to win, watchability 7.
Yeah, that's the one thing about Purdue is I respect how good they are. I respect how good Edie is. They're the least exciting, like, number one seed great college basketball team that I think I've ever watched play. Just the way that it's frustrating watching them and just frustrating watching Edie. And it's because he's good, but it's frustrating watching him go up against a 6'8 center and dominate him and get a whistle anytime that, you know, guy giving up 6 inches puts up any type of a fight against him. It's really frustrating. It's Purdue, for as good as they are, they're not an exciting watch like a UConn is, or even Houston is more fun to watch than them. But that's what knocks me down a little bit here. Now, I'd be at a 6 or 7. I do think Purdue will get it done because you look at both these teams and they're pretty much the two most post-centric offenses in the country. And so it's going to be post-ups with Zach Edey versus Graham EK, and Zach Edey will win. Purdue will win the game.
A lot of half-court basketball going on in that one. Where is that game being played?
Detroit.
Detroit, that's right. Now, watchability for the next game on Friday night, and the one I cannot wait to stay up and watch, is a 10 for me in the South with 2-seed Tennessee, your team, going up against 3-seed Creighton, my team. I've got some money on Creighton to get to the Final Four.
My team in my bracket, but I do love watching Creighton too.
Oh, so. I know. They're both fun to watch. I am actually going to take Creighton to win this game. Tennessee struggled a little bit with Texas. I know Creighton went double OT with Oregon. Those were two kind of fun games, especially the Creighton-Oregon game. Oregon played really well in that game. I'm going to go Kalkbrenner did not do much and hasn't really done much, but he didn't do much against Oregon. I see him doing a little bit more damage. I can't wait to watch Connect. He's going to have his big game, you know, for Tennessee. I'm not a true believer in Tennessee as a 2-seed. I'm going to go Creighton on to the next round and watchability 10.
I'm totally with you on the 10. I think this is going to be one of the best games of the tournament. when I was going through my bracket and filling it out, this is the game that took me the longest to decide.
Yes.
Because I knew that I wanted to take the winner of this game to beat Purdue, because I actually like how both these teams match up with Purdue theoretically. But this game, I think, is going to be fascinating. I ended up going with Tennessee in my bracket. I'll stick with it. I say Tennessee gets a close win here.
Yep.
But I would not be surprised. Creighton, thing with Creighton, too, is they've got so many shooters that yes. if they just go off from three, Tennessee's not going to have a chance in this game. At the same time, Tennessee, one of the better defensive teams in the country, and they've probably got the best individual player on the court in Connect. So it's going to be an awesome game. I will ride with my bracket and go with the Vols.
All right. I wanted to go to the U of I Atlanta Lake text line real quick. Ben and Bourbonnais said, with busy show tomorrow, I wanted to get this out there. Brad will need to become his old intense self for Thursday's game with how physical ISU defense is. I hate saying ISU because I think of Illinois State. Iowa State. Need to get in officials to make sure there is a tight whistle. Also, this could be Coleman's masterpiece with how much he complains to the refs. If he can do the masterpiece of complaining and splash some threes, I think that's that'd be a good call. So a good call, Ben, on the U of I Atlanta Lake text line. Kenny said, Central Illinois connection to that NC State game. The assistant for NC State is Kareem Richardson, who graduated from Rantoul in 1992. I remember reading and hearing about Kareem Richardson. He was 4 years younger than me. There's nobody older than me, actually. So it was cool to see that. And he, of course, is an assistant for NC State. So I appreciate that, Kenny. And we'll be on the lookout for that. That'd be cool for him to be able to advance into an Elite Eight game. All right, we finish in the East. The early game is UConn and San Diego State. My watchability on this is 10 because I need to really focus in on UConn, although I might be scared to crap.
Right.
And just be like, I don't want to watch anymore. I may take my blanket and go in the corner and, you know, just put a thumb in my mouth and just be like, I don't want to play them. By the way, I haven't used a blanket in a while, like just like watching TV. You know, I'm not one of those. You a blanket guy? Like, do you
no,
sit on the couch?
I'm not. And
neither am I. But I'll take UConn over San Diego State. I would say, honestly, watchability is probably an 8, but I'm going to watch it because I want to see what would be next for Illinois should they get by the Cyclones.
Yeah, I've seen enough UConn this year that I don't necessarily factor that into it. I would be down at like a 4 or a 5 for this one. It's weird because it's not often that you're this, you know, that there's not this excitement for a national championship game rematch.
I know.
Like, normally when you talk about, well, the national championship game from last year, we get a Sweet 16 rematch, and it's like, well, UConn's going to boat race them. We don't need to watch this.
That and it's San Diego
State. And it's San Diego State, who got pretty lucky to get there last year. So, I don't know. I think UConn should take care of this San Diego
Agreed.
State team. They're just rolling right now. I don't think they're going to see a true test until the next one.
And then there's one. Illinois, the 3 seed against Iowa State. Obviously, watchability 10 or
10,
more.
Yes.
On this one, the way Illinois is playing basketball right now, and the way it started against Iowa, essentially, that final game of the year, winning at Iowa City, running the table at the Big Ten tournament in Minneapolis, I know that. And Brad said it well today, that 9-0 run by Morehead State to start that game, if you flip that around, like if you take Illinois from being down 9-0 from then on, and I know Morehead State made that first half really competitive and even a little bit a few minutes into the second half, but Illinois has played so well. I'm going to be transparent here, Kyle. There's a little bit of me that thinks Iowa State's a good football program, and I don't really ever – get too worked up about Hilton Coliseum and the Cyclones and basketball. They've had some cool guys there, you know, Fred Hoiberg and such has coached there, and I know they've had some really good teams. There's something about the defense versus offense. Normally you'd probably lean defense. I just don't think Iowa State's got the capability to stay up with Illinois, and especially if the Illini can build a lead. Like we talked about in the first hour, if they can build that maybe 6 to 8 point lead and put pressure on Iowa State to get a little bit away from what they like to do. I'm taking the Illini here into the Elite Eight to face UConn. I think Illinois gets this done. We'll give our prediction tomorrow in terms of score, but I'm going Illinois.
I'm right there with you. I think Illinois gets this one done. I think it's really going to come down to what pace is this game played at, which style wins out, because you got an Iowa State team that wants to ugly the game up and win with defense and win in more of a slower paced half court setting. You see an Illinois team that wants to get out and run, get out and transition, play a back and forth game that gets into the 80s and 90s. And whichever, you know, if it's in the 60s, Iowa State, I think, is going to be in control of this one. If this one gets to the 70s or 80s, I think it's going to be tough for Iowa State to keep up, especially late in the game, over 40 minutes. And I'm just inclined to think that with Terrence Shannon and Marcus DeMas playing the way they're playing and the way that this Illinois offense has really clicked here, I tend to think that it's probably going to lean towards Illinois' style, and this game is going to get into the 70s or 80s, and I just don't know if Iowa State can get there with Illinois, with the fact also that I think Illinois is going to have the two best players on the court in this game, which I think means something. I'm going to go with Illinois.
Tomorrow I want to ask you, when we talk about this game, I want you to give kind of a sleeper pick for Illinois in terms of a player. Who needs to show up and have the type of game that we know he's capable of now that we've watched it over an entire season? So I'll put that on you. I'll also do the same thing on that experiment. So I want to know kind of who that sleeper. I know we said that Coleman Hawkins could be the key to having a really big weekend in Boston if it happens. And I think that is true because of the way he can bring the big men out. And I just think if he could have an epic night, if you were lucky enough to survive Iowa State, if he could have an epic night against the big boy for UConn, and I think you would need that in a battle with the Huskies. So that'll be fun to do tomorrow. All right, that's kind of what Kyle and I think. Interested to see what everybody else thinks as we get through into the Elite Eight in this bracket. And then come this weekend, we'll get four of our teams into the Final Four, which should be really fun. All right, when we come back, Brett Bielema had a chance again to speak to the media. We're going to hear from Coach. Also, Josh McCray, maybe. Probably not. At least I called him the right name.
That's right.
Maybe we'll hold McCray for later this week. Maybe Friday we could hear from him and go from there. But certainly Coach Bielema will give his thoughts on kind of where we're at with this Illinois football team. I know it's kind of funny to even think football because it's like, well, wait a minute. We're smack dab in the middle of Sweet 16 with the Fighting Illini basketball team. Even opening day, we're not given much to. And you and I chatted a little bit about that. Oh, by the way, Kyle Gibson today. 5 innings, no walks, 9 strikeouts, 1 run on 4 hits. Is that right? No runs on 4 hits against the Cubs. I'm now excited about
Weren't the Cardinals the spring training champs last year? How'd that work out?
This year we're just trying to get 9 healthy people onto the baseball field every game. That's kind of where we're at now. All right, Brett Bielema is next. I got some work. We've told you about tax day coming up. A tax refund is more than just extra cash in your pocket. It provides an opportunity to improve your financial fitness. What? Busey Wealth Management can help guide you with expert advice and innovative products and services. Did you know the average refund, according to the IRS, is about $3,000? Well, you knew that if you'd been listening to me the last week talk about Busey. Most people plan to pay down debt, but many will use the refund for basic necessities and to boost their savings. You can do stuff by adding to your emergency fund, paying off that debt, save for retirement. How about save for a down payment if you need a car or maybe a house? And you can also, this isn't a bad idea, Kyle, you'll know this one day, invest in your current home. The right home improvement projects will pay you back in the long run. Whether saving for retirement or college, Busey Wealth Management provides the support and resources you need to help achieve your financial goals. Visit any Busey location, call 1-800-67-BUSEY or visit Busey.com today. I just nailed that, Cliff. Busey, member FDIC.
From computer systems to brakes and tires too, at PDR, fixing cars is what they do.
Remember, when you turn the key and the car won't run, call 367-9481 or use their dedicated text-only line at 383-0619. Additional information, including repair quotes and online scheduling requests, available from the website at pdrauto.com. Remember, they are what's best for your truck or car. They are PDR.
Stevie J Broadcasting is giving you a chance to win a pair of tickets to see some cast members from Ancient Aliens Friday, March 29th at the Virginia Theater.
Don't miss out when Ancient Aliens Live lands in a town near you. The Out of This World Tour continues. Hear from the experts of Ancient Aliens live and in person.
All of you are on this journey with all of us together.
Win a pair of tickets to see some cast members from Ancient Aliens Friday, March 29th at the Virginia Theater. As you text in Ancient Aliens to try and win a free pair of tickets at 217-359-2255.
Ancient Aliens Live, Project Earth, lands in the Virginia Theater Friday, March 29th. Tickets on sale now at thevirginia.org.
Text in Ancient Aliens to try and win a free pair of tickets at 217-359-2255. Details found at thevirginia.org.
Hi, I'm Tyler Weaver, president of Carpet Weaver's Flooring and Furniture Gallery. Take a look around your home. Is it finally ready for some much-needed updates? If you don't know where to start, then just meet with one of our experts. We'll help you find the perfect waterproof plank floor for your kitchen or that stain-resistant, super-soft carpet for your bedroom. Finish your room update with a custom sofa and chairs, or choose a trendy in-stock dining set that's priced right. Come home to Carpet Weaver's, where floors, furniture, and family meet.
Celebrate the Big Ten champion Fighting Illini during March Madness at Pia's. Watch all the NCAA tournament action on Pia's multiple flat screens. Enjoy specials on buckets of beer with your choice of Coors Light, Miller Lite, or Dos Equis. Pia's, home of the Slugger Burger, will be serving up all your favorite ballgame food. Don't forget the famous fish sandwich, available every Friday 11 to 7 p.m., and the Big Tito's Bloody Mary for all those early games. See you at Pia's. Go Illini!
Think you have to settle for mediocre car insurance to save money? Think again. It's possible to get superior coverage and still save money with Erie Insurance. Customers who switched to Erie saved up to $951. It pays to compare. Switch and save with Erie.
Your Erie agent in Champaign is Thomas and Ellers Insurance.
Annual savings based on new customers surveyed in March 2022 who reported savings when switching auto insurance. Individual premiums and savings will vary.
When it comes to finding a reliable vehicle, look no further than Sarah Champagne, your trusted automotive destination. They carry a lineup of top brands, including Honda, BMW, Subaru, GMC, and Buick. And they're not just about cars, they're about people. Their team is dedicated to providing you with trustworthy service and dependable vehicles that fit your lifestyle. Experience the difference at Sarah Champagne. Visit Sarah, S-E-R-R-A, Champagne.com.
At Pards in Urbana, the boots just keep on coming. They're known for their huge collection of men's cowboy boots, women's cowgirl boots, kids' boots, and even shoes. If you're searching for top footwear brands, look no further than Pards. They carry a wide variety, including Ariat, Dan Post, Smoky Mountain, Roper, Double H, and more. And if socks or accessories are what you need, they've got all your high-quality essentials. Since 1968, Pards has been serving their customers with high-quality merchandise. And if you haven't been to Pards in a while, a lot has changed. Go check them out just off University Avenue in Urbana.
Just had a fun weekend here. We actually just finished with the IHSA football clinic, which was the largest I think they've ever had here. Just a lot of really good interaction starting from Thursday night till Saturday with the Hall of Fame banquet. I know it's the largest banquet as well as clinic. To have that growth just in our 4 years of being here, and a lot of positive feedback from Illinois high school coaches. We also have invited in and formulated a format that brought in high school coaches from all over the country, a lot of states surrounding us here that brought in some great speaking and really, really fun, productive weekend. In general, we got through practices 1 through 3. We were in spiders and helmets, practice 1 and 2, at our first full day on Saturday. We were able to be out on the grass, literally, and right outside our stadium here, and get on the grass, full pad of practice, had a really productive 2-hour practice. A lot of really good things showed up, I think offensively, defensively, special teams got good work in. We'll jump into week 2 We'll throw our little bit different schedule this week because of Easter weekend. Just kind of looking at it over the last couple of years, giving our guys a chance to celebrate Easter with their families and whatnot. So we're practicing on Tuesday, Thursday, Friday of this week, not going on a normal Saturday practice. That'll get us through week two and then jumping into the final 3 weeks of spring football on the back end of that. I think offensively to see the growth of our team, you know, certain positions, obviously Luke at quarterback, but really get excited about a couple guys. Donovan Leary has been really, really good. Kirkland Michaud have been equally impressive. And a new guy, Trey Petty, like what he did this first week of being in spring football. And then Josh McCray and Aiden Lofty really are two top running backs that are healthy and fully cleared. Have had a really productive week. Offensive line-wise, the standard usual Geske has made a huge jump. Josh Kreutz, I think Zy Chrysler, but a couple of new guys into the mix. J.C. Dave has been very impressive at left tackle, what he brings to the skill set. Melvin Priestley, another new guy. Kevin Wigginton to a certain level at center and guard. I really like that growth and that development in the tight end room. Griffin Moore probably had his best week since I've been in here. But Tanner Arkin has continued to come forward and do really, really good things. And then a new guy in Cole Rusk, really, really impressed with his first week of spring ball here in the program. Flipping on the other side, and then a wide receiver, Pat Bryant, just continues to be the alpha in the room. Very impressed with his leadership where he is. I would say that a couple of young guys, Malik Elzey, Ashton Hollins, both had good weeks. A couple of guys, Keon Battle, that showed up and did some stuff. Alex Capka-Jones, Hank Beatty, a couple of new arrivals, Kanari Wilcher, new arrival in Rio. Sanders is really impressed with that room, and more impressed Coach Stepp, just really what he brings to the table. A huge impact on our program defensively, from the back end forward, or from the front end back. Really like Alex Bray and what he brought to the room, but Dennis Briggs, Anthony, and Sledge was a little bit banged up, so we couldn't get him in there, but really like on the front end. Jeremiah Warren, and I would say the guy that made a big jump, in my opinion, T-Rod Edwards, really had a good week and has had a great winter all the way through. On the outside, probably our most talented position room. Obviously, with Clint coming in there and coaching for the first time, like to have a Gabe Ackes, Alec Bryant, Seth Coleman, Trey Smith, Daniel Brown, a newcomer, probably one of our twitchier, more athletic guys on the whole football team. At inside back, we're a little bit banged up, but a guy that has stood out there that's been able to go the whole week, Jared Beatty, Ryan Mead, those two guys in particular really, really showed up last week. Dylan Rojack, a little banged up. Obviously, Kanenna Kangul and James Kreutz was injured. And then in the back end, Miles Scott continues to be the guy that kind of just turns heads and makes everybody kind of get excited about where he's coming, where he's going. Mac Resetich in the safety room. Tyler Strain, we used him a little bit in the nickel. And corner room, some of those young DBs. Chase Canada got rolled up on an ankle, so limited his involvement last week. But really like that group. And special teams-wise, I would say Hugh, Breezy, and David Alano all are hitting the ball extremely well. And Lane Hansen's had a great week as a snapper. So a lot of positives, excited about the new coaches, and ready to jump into week two. With that, I'll open up for questions.
Coach, you've got two new coaches in the Big Ten this year. You're going to see. Do you worry about that now? Do you deal with that at all? Or is that a down-the-road problem or down-the-road issue for you guys?
Two new coaches, you said?
Yeah, Michigan State have new coaches.
I got a new coach in Oregon, got a new coach in Indiana, right? Like, there's a lot of new coaches that, you know, you really get into at certain points during the Odyssey, and you game plan as coaches and you scheme and look at things. Obviously, we have KU coming back on schedule, so we've obviously put in work on them. So, yeah, there's new coaches really at an unprecedented level in the Big Ten Conference. But I think a lot of that is for the coaches. We don't really get into schematics of an opposing team, especially when we're not in divisional play anymore right now. I think, obviously, with Northwestern, Purdue, that's a different segment as they become more of a standard for us. But overall, not really anything at this point. It would be something we take up in the fall for sure. And then depending on when we play them in the year, you know, next year we open up with Eastern Illinois on a Thursday night game that got released. And then obviously to come back and play KU, but KU had transition on their staff as well. So things will probably be a little bit different there as well.
is this as crazy as it's been in your time as a coach in terms of the turnover and all the switches and conferences and all that stuff?
Well, I think anytime you add four new teams to your conference, right, and you go away from divisional play, that in a sense always changes things. But for me, it's been awesome. I really have enjoyed getting to know a couple of new coaches. Coach Smith I'd known before. Dan I'd known a little bit. Lincoln, we crossed paths a couple times when I was in the NFL, and then in college just crossing paths on certain different levels. Jed Fish and I go back a long, long way. Have known each other a number of years. So it's been fun in that regards. And then obviously with the new commission, everything that Tony brings to engage us as coaches, it's been a fun time. I don't think maybe it's an all new high just because of the exposure, but it's really just kind of what football is at this point.
Thanks, George.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hey, Brett, on the offensive line, you've got kind of a mix of guys who are returning who played a lot of snaps, and you've obviously gone and added some impact transfers. So I guess what's the process for you guys of sorting that? I know you mentioned like JC at left tackle. That seems to be kind of a common refrain we hear. So what's the balance of sorting all that out here?
You know, first and foremost, Joey, I think as we went through a critical analysis of where we were a year ago, I don't think we had enough quality offensive line players to fill a too deep the level that we thought we needed in the Big Ten play. And especially, you know, when all of a sudden Dez was not available, had some injuries of our current returning players, as well as guys from a year ago. Julian Pearl has a pretty significant hand injury early in the Kansas game, right, to missing some guys banged up with some knee injuries that we missed. So just overall felt we needed to build that depth in that roster a lot higher than it was in the offensive line position. So that was priority number one. We added some live bodies to it. Now to get our best five and really to have our top 8 to 10 players that were available for us, you want to have a solid 2 deep and a swing, which would obviously bring you to a 12 to 13 man offensive line group. But I think just to get a solid, our 5 best players, our top third at both center guard and tackle takes you to 8 guys, you know, at a minimum. But I think if we can get 8 to 10, maybe 11 guys that we feel can win football games, that's the goal that we're on right now.
I just have kind of a housekeeping question. It looked like, and I don't know if I saw this wrong, in the practice we saw that Tyson Rooks may have been a wide receiver, at least somebody wearing number 9 and looking like him. Is he moved there?
Yeah, he has. I'm sorry, I should have said that in last week's press. So yeah, Tyson Rooks, you know, we just kind of took a look at where he was and where we thought he could go out of high school. I actually, when we recruited him, I intended him to play on offense, but we were a little thin on defense. So we moved him to that. He did well in his first year that we did it, and then just presented him with the opportunity during the out of season, and he jumped at it and really has been a fairly impressive kid here through winter conditioning in the first week of spring ball.
Thanks, Brett.
Yep.
Hey, Brett, I want to ask you about two guys you added last year from the JUCO ranks, Prince Ford and Caleb Patterson. What have you seen from them as they enter their second year, and what do you need to see from them to kind of get into that mix there in the second
year? Yeah, you know, Caleb actually joined us, you know, halfway through the year last year and was a really impressive talent coming out of junior college. We're excited to be around. Last year, about midway through the year, we put him on as a guy that defends on our punt return package, which we basically put a guy on their top coverage guy, kind of like Sydney and Quan, and were our top coverage guys 2 years ago at that gunner position, right? And he literally covered some of the best players in our conference at a high level on that unit, which got us excited about what he could do as a cover corner. So he's had a really good winter, and I would say through week one, probably the most impressive corner that stood out of the guys that weren't in the playing rotation a year ago. So really excited about him. Prince Ford does flash, does some things. The problem, obviously, he came in at a light corner that needs to have added body weight, and he hasn't done anything to change that, right? So until he changes that, we really can't put him in a position to be on the field for us. So there's some things he's got to take care of away from the game that I'm excited for. But those two guys in particular had a lot of reps last week and played at a high level.
And with the young guys behind them, Jaheim, Zach, and Sabor, them getting some experience last year, how does that translate into this spring that you've seen?
You know, and you probably saw Sabor, we moved to the safety position. Him and Mac Resetic got a lot of reps at the boundary safety, which is where Matt Bailey would be, Demetrius Hill. But Sabor in particular had a really good week. I thought he made a huge jump. You know, again, a kid that just, you know, very impressive out of high school, loved his upbringing, loved what mom did with him, Renice, his mom. Wish we could send her about 20 of our guys, right? She just kind of lies and does things in a way that puts her son in a position to be coachable and have success. He really had a good week and excited to see him grow. I would say, yeah, for her, for sure, Jaheim. And there's one other.
Toby.
Yeah, Zach Toby. Both of them made progress. I think the game for them, especially working with Coach Gibbs in the back end, you know, there was a good week, but I think they're going to make a big jump in the second to third week.
Thanks, Brett.
Yep.
Brett, how did you and your staff evaluate Gabe Yakus' sophomore year, especially since, you know, he was obviously on the top of the scouting report after being a freshman All-American, and now that, you know, Clint can get his hands on him, what does the future look like for him?
Yeah, you know, the biggest part about Gabe is, you know, I think as he came in as a freshman, experienced good success, you know, a little bit of a different look for him from schematically what he did in high school. Much of the same what we went into last year. We did a lot of the same things, but maybe a little bit more of some skill sets that weren't something that he was a familiar with or as good as he wanted to be, and really challenged him to, you know, have a work ethic coming in January. He's not only matched that, he surpassed it. I yesterday afternoon, I was on daddy duty. My wife was with Bella at a birthday party, and I brought Brexley in to work with me for a couple hours yesterday afternoon. And I was trying to sneak peek some scrimmage film and watch that. She was doing work, and then she wanted to go down to the indoor. We went down to the indoor, and Gabe Backus was in there having a workout individually on his own and sweating at a high level. My daughter was like talking to him and saw the work he was putting in on a Sunday afternoon all by himself. So I know the attitude for him is huge. Schematically, I think we could do some things that are going to help him out, perform and play to his strengths. And then also just the growth that I think he took from year one to year two, and the realization of where he wanted to get to be in year three is going to be a huge step.
Just a quick housekeeping. Just in these 15 spring practices, what are the rules on how much you can scrimmage and how much will you scrimmage with these guys over those?
Yeah, 15? The NCAA, you're allowed to have three total scrimmages where it's nothing but scrimmages. So right now we have those scheduled for the 6th, 13th, and 20th. Obviously, the spring game's an easy one. The 6th, we'll have it. The 13th, I think, would be a modified day. But they also open up the rules a little bit, so there's those three scrimmage days, but there's 5 days that you can use as full tackle days where you can maybe work a certain number of plays as long as the percentage falls under where it needs to be. So we'll sprinkle those 5 days in kind of usually about every Tuesday, but we'll change that up as needed.
Thanks, Brett.
Yep.
A couple of recruiting questions. Looks like you've had, you know, plenty of high school kids coming in to check out spring practices. What are the new coaches on your staff added from a recruiting standpoint? Are there some new faces that they're out there chasing?
Yeah, you know, on the offense side, Justin Stepp comes in really just a guy that, you know, himself describes himself as a relentless recruiter. I would think just the part that's been very impressive to me is not only, you know, since his arrival, but every day since then, just his daily process, his routine that he goes through, has engaged me with, you know, he coaches obviously the wide receiver, so he's recruiting receiver. So we've really, I've been blown away with the daily contact that he has with me that allows me to help recruit receivers that we're after. But also, I think we're going to maximize his area in the Dallas area, as well as, you know, maybe areas he's been at from the area he's from in South Carolina and all that goes into it. On the defense side of the ball, very similar story. Archie McDaniel, who played at A&M, is from Texas, has been extensive in certain areas in Dallas. We'll definitely maximize that and use him a little bit in our junior college recruiting, as well as a couple other areas that we'll kind of, you know, put him in. Without a doubt, we'll use Clint in his area that he's in Virginia, but also he'll be our primary recruiter on the East Coast and in New Jersey. And then David Gibbs, he and I first really began to be around each other and become as close as we've been over the last 30 years through our recruiting areas in South Florida. He's really done a great job of recruiting Florida his entire career, and he fits naturally into that Orlando east side of Florida as best we can. And then really because of the addition of those four guys and their strengths, I'm going to keep Thad in the St. Louis area, but with his new role as our assistant head coach, really expand his recruiting efforts and give him more of an area in South Florida, as well as the area he had in North Florida. Redefined our Ohio area. You know, if you guys go back to my original staff, I really wanted Ohio to be a point of emphasis in recruiting. And then because I had hired Ben to do that and the transition that we had there, it's really been kind of hard to establish someone. So to expand JMO's role in Ohio, as well as possibly one or two other guys that could dip into Ohio as well, is something we're really taking a look at.
Accumulation, preservation, generation. At Busey Bank, these are the principles we use to build meaningful financial partnerships with our clients and their families. With sound advice and vast resources, partner with Busey for a personalized approach to your legacy. Busey Bank, building business, growing wealth since 1868. Proud to be the official bank of the Fighting Illini. Member FDIC.
BMW, Buick, GMC, Honda, and Subaru. Welcome to Sarah Champaign. We can handle all your car repairs on site, including paintless dent repair, bumpers, windshields, everything in between. We have an amazing selection of new or pre-owned vehicles to choose from. Shop from home and buy online or reserve your vehicle before it hits our website or dealership. Sarah Champaign is home of the Sarah One Price Promise, delivering an honest and transparent buying experience. Hurry in or shop online at sarahchampaign.com.
At ABC Heating and Air, it's our promise to help you always be comfortable. Do you need rescued because you're burning hot? Do you need rescued because your air is shot? Call ABC Heating and Air at 352-5400 and let us rescue you from the heat. ABC Heating and Air, 352-5400. Can't you see you need to call me at ABC? Call ABC Heating and Air. That's ABC Heating and Air, 352-5400.
Good vibes.
And I'm Luke Goody from your men's basketball team. Steve, I have a question.
Shoot!
We've talked about Sony, but I know you have LG and Samsung too. Aren't they all kind of the same?
Ah, that's a tough one. Samsung is famous for their bright, colorful picture and the frame TV.
They look like art, right? What about LG?
Okay, Sony invented OLED, but LG perfected OLED manufacturing. That efficiency makes LG the number one selling OLED TV in the country, and their build quality is excellent.
Yeah, they're really flat too. So, why Sony?
Sony makes movies, cameras, monitors. Accurate image is crucial. Colors, skin tones, contrast, motion handling are just some of what Sony does better. Sony buys panels from Samsung and LG and improves them with their own video processing.
Wait, a Sony might have an LG screen?
Yeah, or even Samsung. You've heard how a great coach can take your team and beat his?
I get it. Sony can use other guys' parts and still make a winning product?
All to get that red hair just the right shade and no blur on the swish.
Since 1917, Clay Dooley Tire and Auto has been committed to helping you drive with confidence. Firestone tires can make all the difference on the road. Plus, take advantage of the road-ready financing options. Get the tires and services you need now and pay over time. Clay Dooley Tire and Auto, just off Neal Street. Call 217-352-4286.
Clay Dooley Tire and Auto. Proven, trusted, your friends and
in an ever-changing real estate market, it is so important to work with experienced agents like Russ and Nick Taylor with the Taylor teams at Taylor Realty Associates. They have the knowledge and expertise to get your home sold for the most amount of money in the shortest amount of time. Trust the experience and success of Russ and Nick Taylor with the Taylor team at Taylor Realty Associates. Give them a call today at 217-355-0700 or visit them online at taylorboys.com. That's taylorboys.com.
Welcome to Dick Van Dyke Appliance World.
Hi, I'm looking for a refrigerator.
When you buy from us, you get the whole store.
Oh, yeah, well, I just need a refrigerator. Don't need the whole store.
But you get it, the whole store.
My kitchen is only about this big.
You get me.
Hello.
All those delivery, installation, and service technicians in back.
Wow, all those people?
The Dick Van Dyke 5-10-year protection plan, which means in the unlikely event something goes wrong in the first 5 years, your repair cost is nothing.
Nothing?
10 years parts coverage on the major components.
Looks like I'm getting more than the refrigerator today. How much does this whole store cost?
Nothing.
Come on.
For real. We guarantee to beat any competitor's deal, all that other stuff we talked about, like our service tax.
And your 5-10-year protection plan.
All included.
I'm Dennis Freak, and chairman of Dick Van Dyke Appliance World. And when we say you get the whole store, we mean the whole store. Wow!
Dick Van Dyke Appliance World. When you buy from us, you get the whole store.
At Pards in Urbana, the boots just keep on coming. They're known for their huge collection of men's cowboy boots, women's cowgirl boots, kids' boots, and even shoes. If you're searching for top footwear brands, look no further than Pards. They carry a wide variety, including Ariat, Dan Post, Smoky Mountain, Roper, Double H, and more. And if socks or accessories are what you need, they've got all your high-quality essentials. Since 1968, Pards has been serving their customers with high-quality merchandise. And if you haven't been to Pards in a while, a lot has changed. Go check them out just off University Avenue in Urbana.
When you make the right decision, it feels good, like picking the perfect accent rug or choosing a good night's sleep over an all-night crime show binge. It feels really good to make the right insurance decision, too. That's why State Farm agent Kurt Lenschow is right here in Champaign-Urbana to help you select the right protection at the right price. Kurt will make sure you understand your State Farm coverages so you'll know what to expect if the unexpected happens. Just call him when you want the real deal. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
You're listening to WSJK ESPN 93.5 Tuscola, Champaign-Urbana, your home for the St. Louis Cardinals.
This is